أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Lesson number 177, Surah An-Nur, ayah number 11-20. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ جَاءُوا بِالْإِفْكِ. Indeed, those people who came with the ifk, with the falsehood, who are they? عُصْبَةٌ مِّنْكُمْ. They are a group from among you. They're not mushrikeen, but rather who are they? A group from among you, O Muslims. And with regards to this incident of ifk, لا تحسبوه شرا لكم. Don't think it to be evil for you. بل هو خير لكم. Rather, it is good for you. And لكل امرئ, for every person, منهم, from them, for every person among those who participated in this incident, is مكتسب من الإثم, what he acquired of sin. والذي تولى كبره منهم له عذاب عظيم. And as for the one who took upon himself the greater portion of it, then for him is a great punishment. This ayah and the following ayat were revealed concerning the incident of al-ifk. Ifk means lie. And this incident is called al-ifk because this was when the wife of the Prophet ﷺ, Aisha radhiyallahu anha, Ummul Mu'mineen, she was accused of something. She was accused without any knowledge, without any evidence, of having committed zina. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls that accusation ifk. And this entire incident is known as al-ifk. And this incident, it took place after the ghazwa of Banu Mustalaq. It is reported in Musnad Ahmad that Aisha radhiyallahu anha, the wife of the Prophet ﷺ, she narrated that incident herself as to what exactly happened. She said that when the Prophet ﷺ, whenever he wanted to go for a journey, he would cast lots among his wives. And the one whose lot was drawn would go with him. So every time the Prophet ﷺ went for a journey, what would he do? He would cast lots. And whosoever name would come up, she is the one who would accompany the Prophet ﷺ for that journey. What do we learn from this? The fairness, the justice of the Prophet ﷺ, so that he does not become biased in choosing who he wants to take with him. And also something very important, that he took his wife with him whenever he traveled. One of the wives would at least go with him on every trip of his. Obviously, a safe trip, but we see that for this trip, this was a ghazwa, this was supposed to be a battle, but still he took one of his wives, so that they also get a chance to get out of the house, go and see the creation of Allah, get to travel and experience and learn about new things. So this is something that is very, very important. And Aisha radhiyallahu anha, she said that, so he drew lots among us with regard to a campaign that he was going to go out on. And mine was drawn. So I went out with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this was after the commandment of hijab had been revealed. This was after the command of hijab had been revealed. So I traveled in my hawda. What is a hawda? Hawda is basically, you can say, like a small case which is covered from all sides and it's placed on top of a camel, so that the person who is sitting inside is protected from the heat, is protected from the sun. And especially this was used for women, so that they would be comfortably sitting inside and the people from outside, the men, could not see them. And if you look at it, a hawda was made so that the women could travel, because think about it, wearing a niqab the whole time is extremely difficult. So they were given private cases in which they could easily sit, and they were covered, they were protected from the heat of the sun, and at the same time, they were sitting comfortably. So she said that I traveled in my hawda and I stayed in it when we camped. We traveled until the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam completed his campaign, and then we returned. As we were approaching Al-Madinah, we paused for a while. And then they announced that the journey was to be resumed. When I heard this, I walked quickly away from the army to answer the call of nature. And then I came back to my hawda. Then I put my hand to my chest, and I noticed that a necklace of mine had broken. So you can imagine, she's going on a journey, but still she's wearing a necklace. Why? To beautify herself for who? For her husband. This is something very important. And when she came back after using the washroom, she realized that her necklace had broken. So I went back and looked for it, and was delayed because of that. And in the meantime, the people who used to lift my hawda onto the camel came along and put it on the camel, thinking that I was inside. And in those times, women were more slender and not so heavy, because they only ate mouthfuls of food. Because you see, life in Medina, especially at the beginning, was not easy. For many, many years, they weren't able to light any lamps even. They didn't have enough oil. If they had the oil, they would consume it. So you can imagine that the women, they would not eat that much food. They would only eat mouthfuls at a time. Therefore, they were very slender and they were not heavy. So the people did not think anything of the hawda being so light when they lifted it up, as I was a young woman as well at that time. So Aisha radhiyallahu anha, being young, being also very light, when the people picked up the hawda, they didn't realize that she wasn't inside. And what happened? They set off. And I found my necklace after the army had moved on. Then I came back to the place where we had stopped, and I saw no one to call or answer. So just imagine, she's looking for a necklace, she comes back and she finds that everybody has gone. This is where? In the middle of the desert. This is not a gas station. This is not a gas station where people usually stop. So if your family has left, if your bus has gone, then what can you do? You can go and sit somewhere and call them. No, there was no way of calling them back. She saw no one to call or answer. So I went to the place where I had been, thinking that the people would miss me and come back for me. Eventually they'll realize that I am missing and they'll come back for me. And while I was sitting there, I fell asleep. She was waiting, until eventually she fell asleep. Safwan ibn al-Mu'attal, he was a companion of the Prophet ﷺ, he had rested during the night behind the army. Because whenever the Prophet ﷺ would travel, he would always have someone follow the caravan after the caravan had moved on from a place. So the caravan would be traveling at a particular pace, but there would always be one person traveling behind the caravan. So he had camped elsewhere during the night. And now that he reached this place, why did he reach this place? Because he was on his way following the caravan. And his responsibility was to make sure that the caravan had not left behind anything important. And if there were any lost objects, if there were any forgotten objects, he would pick them up and he would take them to Medina with him. So this was his responsibility. Isn't this so wise? Because imagine a whole caravan is traveling, a lot of people are traveling, it's very much possible that something important could be left behind. And so when the people realize that something is missing, instead of the entire caravan turning back, you have one person whose responsibility is to constantly check where the caravan had camped. So then he set out just before daybreak and reached the place where I was in the morning, where he saw the outline of a sleeping person. So she was sleeping. And when he reached, he saw there is a person who is sleeping. When he saw me, he came to me and he recognized me when he saw me. When he came to me, when he came closer, he recognized Aisha radhiyallahu anha, as he had seen me before hijab was made obligatory for me. What do we understand from this? That the sahabiyat, before the ayat of hijab were revealed, they did not cover their faces. Because obviously, how would you recognize a person? By their face. So when the ayat of hijab were revealed, she's not saying that were exclusively for us. What did she say? Just the ayat of hijab. So she said that before the ayat of hijab were revealed, he had seen me. Therefore, he recognized me from my face. And afterwards now, when he saw me, although I had been covering my face now, but when he saw me, he recognized me. So this shows to us that before the ayat of hijab were revealed, the women would not cover their faces. But afterwards, they began covering their faces. So he came to me and recognized me when he saw me, as he had seen me before the hijab was made obligatory. When he saw me, he said, "Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un." To Allah we belong and to Him we shall return. And with that I woke up and I covered my face immediately with my jilbab. By Allah, He did not speak a word to me and I did not hear Him say anything except "Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un," until He brought His camel and made it kneel so that I could ride upon it. And then he set out leading the camel until we caught up with the army at Zuhr time. So he reached there in the morning, And what happened? By Zuhr time, they had caught up with the army. But what do we see? That Safwan, he did not ask Aisha radiallahu anha, what happened and how are you here? Are you okay? Have you eaten? When did the army leave? Nothing. Nothing at all. Because he knew that when there are two people who are unrelated, a man and a woman, who is the third? Shaitan. So to keep Shaitan far away as much as possible, what did he do? He didn't even say one thing to her. Except for that statement, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un, which was enough to wake her up. And that's it. Just by a signal, he lowered his animal, she sat on the animal, and then he walked with the animal. So this is something very, very important. Because many times we think that it's okay. It's okay, just say, how are you doing? How was your day? So what did you do? This is what we think casual conversation is about. But we see that this is what leads to evil. This is what leads to fitna. So he did not say anything, and she did not say anything. Because they knew the limits that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had set. And she said that there are people who are doomed because of what happened to me. And the one who had the greater share therein was Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul. Why are these people doomed? Because when Aisha radiallahu anha, when she was approaching and Safwan was leading her, Abdullah ibn Ubay, the leader of the hypocrites, the chief hypocrite, what did he say? That something evil has happened, indicating that zina had happened between the two of them. And remember that Abdullah ibn Ubay, he had a lot of hatred for the Prophet ﷺ. And not just hatred, but also jealousy. Why? Because before the Prophet ﷺ migrated to Medina, Abdullah ibn Ubay was supposed to be made the king of Medina. To the point that even his crown was being prepared. And when the Prophet ﷺ came, everybody forgot about Abdullah. And Abdullah, although he apparently became Muslim, but he had this grudge, this hatred, this jealousy for the Prophet ﷺ. So at every occasion, that jealousy, that hatred would come out. Like we learned that at the Battle of Uhud, what happened? On the way to the battle, he said, we're going back. And he took many of his men along with him back to Medina. So at every occasion, his enmity for the Prophet ﷺ would be exposed. And this is a reality, that something that's in your heart, no matter how much you try to hide it, eventually it comes out. You cannot hide it. So at this point, he said something very, very evil about Aisha radiallahu anha. When we came back to Medina, I fell ill for a month. Aisha radiallahu anha, she became ill, and for an entire month she was ill. And the people were talking about what the people of slander were saying. There was a group of people who became the people of slander. They had slandered Aisha radiallahu anha. And I knew nothing about it. Now this whole talk is going on in the city. Everybody's talking about it. This rumor has spread very quickly. And Aisha radiallahu anha, being ill, being in her house, she had no idea that such things were going on about her. What upset me when I was ill was that I did not see the kindness that I used to see on the part of the Prophet ﷺ. Because he was very affectionate and very loving towards his wives. And especially Aisha radiallahu anha. Because she was the most beloved to him out of all of his wives. Obviously Khadija radiallahu anha was definitely beloved. But of those who were alive, we see that Aisha radiallahu anha was the most beloved to him. And when she was ill, the Prophet ﷺ did not show the usual kindness, the usual affection that he would show. So that made Aisha radiallahu anha a bit concerned, and that made her upset. I did not feel that there was anything wrong until I went out after I felt better. So after an entire month, when she recovered from her illness, she went out one night, and Mistah, she went out with me, walking towards Al-Manasik, which is where we used to go to answer the call of nature to relieve ourselves. And we would not go out for that purpose except at night. Another very important lesson that we see, that the women, they would go to the washroom, when? At night time. And imagine they're going only once. What does that show? How little they ate, how little they drank. What happens with us? We're constantly drinking caffeine. We're constantly eating one thing after the other, which is why we have to keep running to the washroom. We have to keep renewing our wudu. Because many times I see people cannot sit in the classroom for even 1 hour, for even 2 hours, except for illa mashallah, which are alhamdulillah many, but there are also many who are unable to sit for too long. Why? Because we're constantly eating, constantly nibbling. So we see that the women at that time, they would go to the washroom only once, and that too at night time. And obviously they would not go alone, so she went with Mistah. So she said that I went out with Mistah, who was the daughter of Abu Ruhm ibn al-Muttalib ibn Abd Munaf, and her mother was the daughter of Sakhr ibn Amir, the paternal uncle of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. So basically, she was one of the distant relatives of Aisha radhiyallahu anha. And her son was Mistah ibn Usasa. And he was one of those people who had participated very actively in accusing Aisha radhiyallahu anha. So what happened then? When we finished what we had to do, Mistah and I came back towards my house. So Mistah, while we were coming back, she stumbled over her apron. And she said, "May Mistah be ruined." You know, it happens sometimes that you bump into something, you fall, and somebody whom you're very angry at, somebody whom you're very upset with, you say something negative about them. So Mistah, what did she say at that moment? That, "May Mistah be ruined." So I said to her, "What a bad thing you have said." Aisha radhiyallahu anha, she said to Mistah, "What a bad thing you have said about your son. Are you abusing a man who was present at Badr? How can you say something like that about him?" So she said, "Good grief, have you not heard what he has said?" I said, "What did he say?" So she told me what the people of the slander were saying, which made me even more ill. So just imagine, she had no idea. And now all of a sudden somebody tells her, she's already not well, and it made her even more ill. When I returned home, the Prophet ﷺ, he came in and he greeted me. And he said, "How is that lady?" Meaning, how are you? Indirectly, how is that lady? Which shows that there was something wrong. So I said to him, "Will you give me permission to go to my parents?" At that time I wanted to confirm the news by hearing it from them. Just imagine, she was so patient that as soon as the Prophet ﷺ walked in, she didn't say, "Do you believe in what the people have said? Do you trust me or you don't? I never did anything like that." Without even saying anything, she asked for permission in order to go to her parents' house, because she wanted to get that information confirmed from her parents. We see the patience of Aisha radhiyallahu anha. She does not react immediately. And before reacting, before saying anything to her husband, she wants to make sure that what she has heard is true, because she has heard it only from one person. And who does she trust? Her parents. So she wanted to confirm from them. And this is something very, very important, that many times it happens that some misunderstanding has taken place between a wife and a husband. Misunderstanding. And without finding out about the situation, immediately what happens? The wife blows up at the husband, and the husband blows up at the wife, and later on they find out it wasn't really a big deal. Some matters, you have to be very, very careful with them. You cannot react immediately. And you need to consult your parents first. You need to consult somebody else first before talking to your husband, before talking to your wife. So this is what we see, the wisdom, the patience of Aisha radhiyallahu anha, before reacting in front of her husband or before even speaking to him about that. She wishes to go speak to her parents first. So the Prophet ﷺ, he gave me permission. So I went to my parents' house. And what happened? They confirmed the news. And I said, "Subhanallah, are the people really talking about that? Are the people really talking about that?" She was shocked, she was amazed. And she said that, "I wept throughout the whole night until morning." Imagine, she was a young girl, innocent woman. She had not done anything wrong. She was ill. And she was a wife of the Prophet ﷺ. And she had been accused of a crime that she would never even think of committing. So imagine how sad she must have been. So she wept throughout the whole night until morning. And she said, "My tears never ceased, and I did not sleep at all. And morning came while I was still crying. I was still weeping." And she said that because the revelation had ceased, the wahi had not come, the Prophet ﷺ, he obviously could not confirm, could not deny, could not do anything, especially when everybody was talking about it. So he called Ali ibn Talib and Usama ibn Zayd. and he consulted with them about this matter. So then the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam got up and he addressed the people and he asked who could sort out Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul for him, that who could deal with this person for me. Because remember, Abdullah ibn Ubay, he was apparently a Muslim and he was from the people of Medina. He was not of the Muhajirun. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because he did not have any tribal relations with him, he could not even take any action against him himself. And obviously, being a leader, he could not just pick on someone and do anything against him. So he consulted the companions that who can deal with him for me. While he was standing on the mimbar, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, O Muslims, who will help me against a man who has hurt me by slandering my family? By Allah, I know nothing about my family but good. And the people are blaming a man of whom I know nothing except good. Who is he referring to? Safwan. And he has never entered upon my family except with me. So Sa'd ibn Mu'adh al-Ansari, he stood up. And he said, O Messenger of Allah, by Allah, I will deal with him for you. If he is from the tribe of Al-Aws, then I will cut off his head. And if he is from the tribe of our brothers, meaning Al-Khazraj, tell us what to do and we will do it. So then Sa'd ibn Ubadah, he stood up. And he was the leader of the Khazraj tribe. And he was a righteous man, but he was overwhelmed with tribal chauvinism. And he said to Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, by Allah, you will not kill him, and you will never be able to kill him. Because Abdullah ibn Ubay was from his tribe. Then Usayd ibn Hudayr, who was the cousin of Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, he stood up and he said to Sa'd ibn Ubadah, you are lying, by Allah we will kill him, and you are a hypocrite arguing on behalf of the hypocrites. So then the two groups, Al-Aws and Al-Khazraj, they started to get angry and were about to come to blows, while the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was standing there on the mimbar. So while he was standing on the mimbar, he tried to calm them down until they became quiet. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also fell silent. So just imagine, even when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam attempted to do something, he wasn't able to do anything. On that day, Aisha radhiyallahu anha said that I kept on weeping so much that my tears never ceased and I did not sleep at all, even during the day. So imagine, she spent the night crying and she spent the day crying. And my parents thought that my liver would burst from all that weeping. Just imagine how concerned her parents must have been. And while they were sitting with me and I was weeping, a woman of the Ansar, she asked for permission to see me. I let her in and she sat and wept with me. What do we learn from this? That how much the women of the Ansar, even they loved the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You see this, you know, sisterhood, this friendship that existed between them. That she felt the pain that Aisha radhiyallahu anha was feeling. And she just came to see her, and she sat there just crying with Aisha radhiyallahu anha. She couldn't comfort her with anything, but she just sat there crying with her. While we were in that state, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came in, and he greeted us, and he sat down. He had never sat with me since the rumors began, and a month had passed by without any revelation coming to him concerning my case. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam recited the tashahud when he sat down, and then he said, thereafter, O Aisha, I have been told such and such a thing about you. If you are innocent, then Allah will reveal your innocence. But if you have committed a sin, then seek Allah's forgiveness and turn in repentance to Him. For when a servant confesses his sin and repents to Allah, he accepts his repentance. Look at the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also spoke to her. Because he did not want to speak without knowledge. And he said that, if you're innocent, then remember, don't fear, Allah will reveal your innocence. And if you have done something wrong, then just ask Allah for forgiveness. Allah is Tawwab al-Rahim. He will forgive. He is the one who accepts repentance. Look at how encouraging he is. Just imagine any other man. Any other man whose wife has been accused like this, how would he behave towards his wife? Angry. He would yell at her. He would shout at her. Perhaps physically abuse her. Perhaps divorce her immediately. Send her away immediately. But look at how patient the Prophet ﷺ was. He did not know. He could not confirm. He could not deny. And at the same time, he had positive thinking about his wife. He trusted his wife. This is something very important. That trust should exist between a husband and wife. That you know your spouse so well that you know that if somebody has accused them of something, you cannot believe in them. you cannot accept what they're saying. You trust your spouse. You know that they cannot do anything wrong like that. And if they have done anything wrong, if you even doubt, then what should your concern be? That their matter should be clear with Allah. Because that is the most important thing. If you forgive them, if people forgive them, if no harmful consequences happen in this life, then if something wrong has been done, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can still punish that person. Isn't it so? So at the end of the day, encourage the person to seek forgiveness from Allah. So when the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam finished what he had to say, my tears stopped completely, and I no longer felt even one drop. Then I said to my father, answer the Messenger of Allah on my behalf. He said, I don't know what I should say to the Messenger of Allah. So I said to my mother, answer the Messenger of Allah on my behalf. She said, I do not know what I should say to the Messenger of Allah. So just imagine, she did not want to speak directly because she was hurt, she was sad, and she didn't want to say something that would be disrespectful, that would be wrong, that would be incorrect. She requested her parents to speak. But when they did not know what to say, she had to say something, obviously. So she said, even though I was just a young girl who had not memorized much of the Quran at that time, look at her answer. I said, by Allah, I know that you have heard so much of the story that it has become planted in your minds and you believe it. I know that you've heard it again and again and again, and because of that you almost believe it. So now if I tell you that I am innocent, and Allah knows that I am innocent, you will not believe me. Why? Because you've heard it so many times that you believe that I have done it. If I tell you I'm innocent, you're not going to believe me. But if I admit something to you, and Allah knows that I am innocent, then you will believe me. If I say that yes, I did it, then you will believe me. Whereas in reality, I am innocent. By Allah, I cannot find any example to give you except for that which the Prophet Yusuf's father said, فَصَبْرٌ جَمِيلٌ وَاللَّهُ الْمُسْتَعَانُ عَلَى مَا تَصِفُونَ. That patience is most fitting for me, and it is Allah whose help can be sought against that lie which you describe. I cannot defend myself. I cannot do anything. All I can say is صَبْرٌ جَمِيلٌ وَاللَّهُ الْمُسْتَعَانُ عَلَى مَا تَصِفُونَ. So, you see, she was a young girl at that time. She had not memorized much of the Qur'an. The entire Qur'an had not even been revealed at that point. But whatever she knew, she was able to relate it with her daily life. And that's the beauty of understanding the Qur'an. That she said what the Prophet of Allah had said. Then I turned my face away, and I lay down on my bed. By Allah, at that point, I knew I was innocent, and that Allah would prove my innocence because I was innocent. She said, I knew I was innocent and I was confident that Allah was definitely going to expose my innocence. But by Allah, I did not think that Allah would reveal Quran that would be forever recited concerning my situation, because I thought of myself as too insignificant for Allah to reveal anything concerning me. I never thought that ayat would be revealed, that would be forever recited. By Allah, I hoped that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would see a dream in which Allah would prove my innocence. So she thought perhaps that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would see a dream, and by that he would know that I am innocent. But by Allah, the Messenger of Allah did not move from where he was sitting, and no one left the house before Allah sent down revelation to his Prophet. And he was overtaken by the state that always overtook him when the revelation came upon him, until drops of sweat like pearls would run down him, even on a winter's day. This was because of the heaviness of the words which were being revealed to him. So when that state passed, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was smiling. And the first thing he said was, be glad, O Aisha, Allah has declared your innocence. So my mother said to me, get up and go to him. I said, by Allah, I will not go to him. And I will not give praise to anyone except Allah. I will not give praise to anyone except Allah. May he be glorified. For he is the one who has proven my innocence. Allah is the one who has proven my innocence. Many, many lessons can be learned from the story. Some of the lessons that you were thinking of, what did you learn? that no matter what situation you're going through, when you are upon the haqq, when you know that you're innocent, when you know that what you are doing is right, then stay confident. Be confident. Have yaqeen, have tawakkul ala Allah, that Allah will expose your truthfulness, your sincerity. Don't worry at that time. Because what happens at such situations, we think that we need to prove ourselves right. We need to defend ourselves. But we see that the one who trusts upon Allah, Allah is sufficient for him. At a time when she could be so emotional, she was hurt so much, she was crying the whole night, the whole day. She was so hurt. But still we see that she wasn't driven by her emotions. She didn't say, give me divorce. That's it, you don't trust me anymore. This is what people do, right? At the slightest thing, at the slightest occasion, this is what women think. At least in their heads, maybe I should just take a divorce from this man. He doesn't trust me. He doesn't treat me well. I didn't even do anything wrong. So we see that she's not driven by her emotions. She's not rude. She does not make a scene. She does not show any negative reaction. She's just crying and praying, crying and praying. That's it. We see that Aisha radhiyallahu anha, she was Ummul Mu'mineen, right? The mother of the believers. And Safwan radhiyallahu anhu, he was the companion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a believer. He did not think, oh, she's like my mother. She did not say, oh, he's like my son. Like we typically think, he's like my brother, she's like my sister. And because of this brother-sister, what do? We cross all limits. Isn't it so? We talk, we chat, we exchange emails, we send text messages, we call, we do one thing after the other, we sit together at a table sipping on coffee, saying what? He's like my brother, she's like my sister. But what do we see? That they did not even speak once. They considered the limits that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had set. And we see Aisha radhiyallahu anha, she said that, I never thought Quran would be revealed concerning me because I considered myself to be too insignificant before Allah. Look at the humility. She was the wife of the Prophet and she knew that the Prophet loved her dearly. She knew that. She was confident about that. But still that didn't make her proud of herself, that didn't make her feel arrogant. Still she remained humble. She found comfort from the stories that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had revealed. She could relate her situation very well with that of Yusuf alayhi salam and his father. This is the benefit of learning the Quran, that we see that she was the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. She was not an ordinary woman, and she was the daughter of Abu Bakr radhiyallahu anhu. Just imagine how special she was, what a high rank she had. But still people had the guts to say that about her. And if somebody ever says something negative about us, what do we think? How could she say this about me? How could they say this about me? I'm supposed to be this and I'm supposed to be that. And I'm supposed to have done this to them and I've done this favor to them. We cannot understand why or how people could speak negatively about us. Remember, this is a part of life. This happens. And it's a bigger shock for someone who is too arrogant, who thinks too great of themselves. So Aisha radhiyallahu anha, being the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, she was slandered. So who are we? Our status is nothing compared to her status. And we see that despite her young age, she was very young at that time. She was a teenager. Perhaps in her very early teens at that time, maybe 13 or 14. But she was very, very young at that time. Now, being that young and reacting in such a calm way, typically what happens? We give the excuse to ourselves, I'm very young, it's okay. I'm a teenager. Teenagers are meant to behave like this. They're meant to react like this. They're meant to show anger. But we see that she does not behave like that at all. She's still very calm, very composed. Just because there was a rumor concerning her, she didn't say anything negative about Mistah. She did not say anything negative about anyone else who was slandering her, accusing her. Because what happens if somebody says something negative about us, we begin to say negative things about them. This is how we fight them. This is how we satisfy our ego. But we see that she was certain that she was right. Therefore she kept silent. And she trusted upon Allah. Allah will take care of this for me. He will expose my innocence. When we're going through some difficulty, then we remember Allah. And as soon as the difficulty is removed, we forget. But what do we see? That as soon as the difficulty was removed, Aisha radhiyallahu anha, she said that when she was told, go to your husband, go to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, she said, I will not go to him and I will not give praise to anyone except Allah, because he is the one who revealed my innocence. A very important lesson. Remember Allah in difficult times and also when the difficulty is removed. And the importance of investigating, the importance of confirming something before reacting, before talking about it. We see that the people who did participate in this slander, in this accusation, they had no evidence. No evidence. But Aisha radhiyallahu anha, she had heard from one person that everybody was talking about it. And before reacting, before saying anything, what did she do? She confirmed. So this is very important. We see that she really controlled her tongue. She did not speak for too long. She did not speak endlessly, trying to defend herself. Look at the words that she said. So composed, so short, so brief, so to the point, so wise. That since you have heard it again and again, if I say I'm innocent, you're not going to believe me. If I say I'm not innocent, you're going to believe me. And I'm only going to say what the Prophet of Allah said. How calm she was, and also something very subtle over here, that she asked for permission to go to her parents' house. She asked her husband if she could go to her parents' house. What do we think? It's my right. Who is he to stop me? Who is he to tell me I can go wherever I want? I have a license, I have the car, I can go. Imagine she's seeking permission to go to her parents' house. Our ego comes in the middle. We think, who is he? How can he stop me? And you know, this is something very, very wise, that women who don't show that respect to their husbands, who try to prove to them that no, I am as equal of a boss as you are, then their husbands don't show respect to them, their husbands don't allow them, their husbands put unnecessary restrictions on them. And if you give the lead to the husband, may I do this, may I do that, can I go here, can I do this, can I do that, then he will give you permission to do whatever you want. But if you try to show to him that I am equal of a boss just as you, then you cannot get anything done. We see that how her parents were also so calm, that they trusted their daughter. They knew that their daughter could not have done anything wrong like that. But typically what happens, if a daughter is accused of something like this, the parents would rebuke the daughter. They would say, you've brought, you know, shame to the family, you've humiliated the family's name, you've insulted us, did we not teach you anything, what did you do? You know, this is how they treat the daughter. But look at her parents, they're equally sad, they're equally concerned. And very, very, very important, that we see that Aisha radhiyallahu anha, when she said to her parents that, please, you speak to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam on my behalf, they say, we don't know what to say. Because many times what happens, if there is an argument, if there is some conflict, some friction between a husband and a wife, what happens? The parents, they come in and they interfere too much in defense of their daughter, in defense of their son. And because of their interference, sometimes what happens? The relationship between a husband and wife becomes destroyed, literally. But we see that they're so wise, they're so calm, they're so composed, that although they love their daughter, they defend her, but still they do not interfere. Let's listen to the recitation. Now there are many, many more lessons that can be learned from this incident. Let's look at the lessons that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taught us in the following ayat.